Okay, welcome everyone, warm welcome here from Flow Science. Today I'm excited to be able to talk to you about Flow-3D Cast v5.1, our next release. Let's get moving, see if we can do this. So first of all, our World User Conference has been rescheduled. Not surprisingly. So we'll be doing this June 7 to 9, 2021. We'll still be in Germany, in Munich, and you're all welcome to join with us. And we're honored to have as a keynote speaker, Hubert Lang with BMW, who'll be telling us about the just amazing work that BMW has been doing over the last 15 years or so. Using Flow-3D Cast. So we're looking forward to that. By all means, please submit your abstracts and come and join us. This year would have been the 40th anniversary of Flow-3D. So next year will be the 41st. It should be really good. So we'll see you all in Munich, I hope, Germany, next year, June 7 and 9. Any questions? The easy email is info@flow3d.com. The more complicated one is me, john.wendelboe@flow3d.com. By all means, just send us your questions and we will answer all of them, of course. Always happy to set up presentations if you'd like for your group, for your company, for your colleagues. And during these kind of presentations, one-on-one presentations, we can go into much more depth about how we do things or how we can solve the problems you're working on or help you at least with the problems you're working on. So don't hesitate, info@flow3d.com or john.wendelboe@flow3d.com. So today we'll talk about, really quickly, just for those who don't know about Flow Science. So a brief introduction, and I'll talk about the 5.1 modeling platform in kind of general terms and some new features with the exothermic sleeves and a new solidification modeling tool that we have. And then I'll talk about new process workspaces and focus on the new ones in 5.1, continuous casting, sand core making, investment casting, and centrifugal casting. So, and then just a couple of slides on high performance computing, because that's just become part of the regular workflow for many of us now in this business. Okay, so Flow Science, back in the days, I guess you could say there were maybe three hotspots for CFD, groups that really got things moving in the 50s and 60s. One was at Imperial College in the UK, the other one, Sheffield University. I guess there were others too, but those are the ones that come to mind in my mind. And then Los Alamos National Labs in New Mexico and in the US. And Tony Hertz, the founder of Flow Science, was part of that group of researchers, and they made a lot of progress with different numerical methods, Mark and Cell method, VAF method, which is foundational to what we do today. So that's kind of a little bit of history there. And in 1980, Tony Hertz founded Flow Science. The software Flow-3D was released in 1985, and it's evolved, obviously, over the years. You know, if you go from, old MS-DOS workstations to 98 and then 2020, and you can see 2020, this is just water, but you can see the complexity of the free surface and how well it's captured using what we call today true VOF technology that we've developed in-house over the years. So that's what's a little bit of history there for you. And if you apply that to casting, metal casting, this is a LPDC example. You can see the quality of the flow is amazing, but it's not just the flow, it's the solidification that happens at the same time. And you can see this is an early freeze, and you can see how well that matches the real part. And that's, I should thank our colleagues at XC Engineering in Italy for doing this model, and I'll let you absorb this a little bit. It's just absolutely remarkable how the simulation matches real life. Okay, And also we should give credit to, more credit, I suppose, to Dr. Tony Hurt, who still works in the office. And just the seminal paper that he wrote with Billy Nichols all those years ago, the volume of fluid method, endures. And it's still today a method that is subject of intense research activity because it's just so well suited to flow, free surface flow. And so if you look at the publications that are cited, Tony and Dr. Nichols over the years, 13,910. It's just amazing how this method has endured. And today, just to tell you a little bit of how we operate, we are mostly based in Santa Fe, New Mexico. We have a group of a crack team of developers, and we work with metal casting, of course, but also additive manufacturing these days, 3D printing, welding, aerospace propellants we've done for a long time, microfluidics, water civil infrastructure, coating. Well, the common theme is free surface flows, as you can tell. And the nice thing about casting is we've been doing this for so long that we have an enormous amount of in-house expertise, application-specific support, a team of dedicated metal casting developers. So it's really a nice group of developers, support engineers, GUI developers, etc., that work in this field of metal casting, which is really one of the most challenging ones out there of all we do. So it's exciting and interesting. Okay, so that was a brief introduction. And so let's talk about Flow 3D Cast 5.1. Should be coming out in about a month or so. So now's a good time to think about, well, what's in that release. So I call it an advanced multi-physics modeling platform, and I'm very attached to the word multi-physics, even though I underlined fundamentally. The Flow 3D Cast is fundamentally multi-physics, and it's important to understand that, and it's really one of our unique strengths. So this means that we have a wide range of modeling capabilities, and we can handle complex physics, and also process parameters are captured in the solution. So this translates to a wide range of casting applications. It also means that you can look at the detail of process modeling, but it also means that you can step back or view things from a little bit higher up and look at the full cycle of process modeling. So you can do a lot of different things in a lot of detail, but also in a kind of a full cycle view of your problem. So in parallel to being versatile and multi-physics, process workspaces is something we introduced in 5.0 a couple of years ago. Process workspaces streamline the model setup. And that's one of the things we are going to talk about today. So to summarize here a little bit, we are a tool that arguably, I think, is powerful, is versatile, is process focused, but also we are able to deliver a streamlined workflow experience for the user. So what do I mean by physics, multi-physics? Well, of course, free surface flow is a fundamental thing that we capture. All that includes heat transfer and thermals, solidification, thermal stress evolution, gas particle tracking, air entrainment, surface tension, turbulence modeling, pressure modeling, especially back pressure, venting. Also for vestment casting, you'll have radiation. So these are all fundamental physics, and we can do all of this very, very well. And part of the reason we so multi-physics is because we've worked in different industries over the course of 40 years. So if you think about what's needed in aerospace and nuclear, consumer products, microfluidics, etc., all of this over the years, we've built this solid base of physical models that we can apply then to the casting industry. And now, in addition to that, you have to be able to model the process. And so that means extra stuff that's not necessarily pure physics. I call that process modeling. And that includes like the ability, for instance, to be able to model moving objects. So plungers, ladle motion, centrifugal motions. You know, in casting, things move. And you have to be able to model those motions. So we can do that. We have specialized things like exothermic sleeves, spray cooling, the machine limitations in an HPDC context, PQ squared limitations, cooling channels, squeeze pins, just the functionality of being able to create a shell in lost wax or investment casting method, so etc. It could be the mold motion. So all of that adds up to the kind of ecosystem that surrounds the casting process. Fully modeling the operational reality that surrounds the physics is the key ingredient that delivers high fidelity process modeling to the user. That's kind of the summary here. The example here is like, what does this mean? So BMW shared this with us. It's a novel delivery system, and the idea is that you're bringing fluid in a very calm way down to the bottom of the mold, and then you're lifting up the delivery point as you're just staying just right below the free surface. So what does this do? It allows you to basically remove turbulence, which means removing oxide defects, air entrapment, and those sorts of things. You're removing that source of defect from the final parts by being clever about the way you deliver the metal to the mold. And so being able to model something, I call this high fidelity modeling, that comes from having that ability to be able to model all sorts of things within the user interface. So it allows you that. The ladle motion, if you want to have a high fidelity reproduction of your short sleeve dynamics, you need to be able to model the detail of how the metal is being delivered into the shot sleeve. That has, the way it's delivered has consequences in terms of air entrainment and oxide formation. So that's what we would refer to when we talk about high fidelity modeling. Here's an example of a breaking wave in a shot sleeve. That is a source of defects in your final part, so we would like to remove that. So being able to look at that detail is something that Flow 3D Cast is very, very good at. You can see the detail and how precise we are in modeling these things. A couple of examples here. So here's on the left, let's see if this starts. On the left here we have slowly, we don't see it moving, it's actually rotating. We are moving with the reference frame of the ring. It's centrifugal process, but you're going to see exactly how the ring fills up. Initially, we have plenty of air in there, of course, then the fluid gets pushed to the perimeter, and then we're going to backfill, and you can see the bubbles making their way back into the core of the system there. So being able to see that in great detail is an example. And then another one here, which is very interesting. It's a kind of tangentially related to casting. It's welding. And this is a laser being pushed down or beamed down onto a plate. And this, what you're seeing there is called keyhole defects. And it's a real thing. That is a source of structural weakness for welded parts. And because of our versatility of our tool, we are able to model even some very complicated processes like this one. So if you want to know what this actually looks like in real life, these are keyhole defects from an X-ray. And this is the kind of things simulation you'll get from a tool like ours. A couple last examples here, just to show you how different these fill sequences are. This is a lost foam example, and you can see if it weren't lost foam, you know, the fluid, the metal would just go all the way down and start filling up from the bottom upwards. Because it's lost foam, it takes a different path of, I guess, of least resistance, you could say, and the fill pattern is just completely different. This has, of course, profound implications on how the fill, on how the part is going to be in the end, and contrast this with a high-pressure die casting example, where first of all we're talking about milliseconds for the fill, and also, you know, very, very high velocities and a completely different flow pattern. So these are completely different, but it's okay because in Flow 3D we are completely capable of modeling both types of fill, and in fact there's very few things that we are not able to model. So the last dimension here before I move on is that you can look at an example of a detail of a process And you can also look at something that's more comprehensive. Let's say we have the mold, the filling of the mold, the dye, the thermal evolution, thermal dye cycling, the temperature management in the mold. So, you know, this is more like a full process followed by the solidification of the parts, ejection and all those things. And then compared to the left, where we're just looking at a detail, but that's also completely fine. We can just, we have full versatility in Flow-3D to look at really whatever we want. So in terms of versatility, what this translates to now in 5.1 is a whole bunch of process workspaces which help you set up your models quickly and efficiently with a high rate of ultimate success. So HPDC, LPDC, some of these are new into 5.1, so I'll talk about these a little bit later in the presentation. And but just to show you where, how when we talk about versatility, we mean versatility. There's pretty much all of the common and not so common processes that are used in the industry are can be modeled today with Flow-3D CAD. So it's worth stepping back and just reminding ourselves why fill accuracy matters. Obviously, accuracy generally matters in the quest for designing a successful part, but many many casting defects are introduced into the final part at the time of fill, and that's really important to understand that. So that's one aspect. And then, of course, it's not always critical, but it makes sense that correct temperature distribution in the metal at the end of fill is a foundation, a solid foundation for correct solidification analysis. And then sometimes you do have short shot early freeze defects analysis, and that's tightly coupled, of course, to accurate fill in addition to correctly modeling the heat transfer. So the detail of molten metal flow plays a critical role in preventing many fill related defects. It's not just us saying this. In fact, we've taken this to heart over the years. Professor Campbell has also shared this view. If we can cast materials into shapes without reintroducing defects, which are in fact a revolution in metallurgy and engineering. Okay, you've probably seen this one before, but it doesn't hurt to show it again, just to show you how accurate fill is today in this day and age. So this is the x-ray on the left, and really what you want to be looking at here is the regions of gas which are perfectly captured by Flow-3D, the splash of course during the fill, but also if you look more carefully here, this is a little bit later in the fill, you see we have a region here of recirculation and gas. This is basically porosity in the flow, gas captured here, and then you have this cloud of bubbles. And that's too small to really account for, you know, as a fully resolved void region. But using our void particles, you can still track where those particles are going to collapse. And in fact, you can see it's extremely well tracked and kind of resolved using the gas particle model that we have. So we really capture the full detail of fill and air entrainment that goes along with it. As an example from BMW, just to show you that it's not just that one case, it's something that's been shown to be really quite robust over the years, okay? And then just examples of cold shots, visually striking how close we are to the real thing, okay? All right, so new features, new workspaces. So let's take a look at exothermic sleeves, and let's just try this simulation here. It's just a solidification, and we are just going to be looking for hotspots, and with those hotspots, trying to get the thermal modulus that accompanies. And there's one that pops up here in the analysis, and then there's going to be a second one. And they have respective moduli of 12 millimeters and 14 millimeters. So what can we do with that? So what we would do then is basically take that information and place a feeder in the correct spot, and possibly an exothermic sleeve that goes with it. So we'll take a look here. We'll just choose a 14 and 16 millimeters, just to be a little bit conservative, and we just place these in the user interface. You place them in the right place from the database. There's your database. So you select your geometry and properties, put them into your model at the locations where you have your hotspots, and then we are going to rerun this, and hopefully this has removed the defect away from the parts and placed it in the riser, which is in fact exactly what happens in this case. I'm on there and one there, just good enough. Okay, so that's how that works. Just the detail of a riser, an exothermic sleeve rather, when the metal reaches the sleeve, it triggers an exothermic combustion reaction, which then keeps the produces heat for the metal to prevent it from freezing. And this is a detail, and if you look at this in the context of an actual part, you'll see how the solidification is happening, but this molten metal is available to continue feeding the parts longer than it would otherwise without the sleeve. Okay, that's one. And then another really interesting development has a new solidification model, which actually won the Best Paper Award 2019 AFS Aluminum and Light Metal Division. So this is groundbreaking work by our developers, and so we are happy to talk about this, and in fact we are going to talk about this in much more depth on in August 2020, a highly technical webinar, FLOW-3D Cast 5.1 chemistry-based solidification model, theory, validation, and practical usage. So stay tuned for that, it's coming in August. For now, what I want to share with you is that the chemistry-based solidification model increases the functionality available in Flow 3D Cast in two ways. One is now you are going to directly input the chemical alloy composition. So at the moment, we're talking about aluminum alloys, silicon and copper. And over time, we'll be adding more there. And the outputs basically now include advanced metallurgical outputs as well as mechanical properties. And what this does in addition to providing new outputs in terms of metallurgy and yield strength and all those things, it's also in the process, the added benefit is an increase in accuracy in simulated porosity region and shrinkages. So double benefits to this model. So it's what does it do? It doesn't talk. It computes for us a whole host of processes that happen during solidification evolution. So we're talking about microsegregation of alloys and thermodynamic equilibrium at the solid-liquid interface. It's all quite advanced. And then macrosegregation due to advection and diffusion. So actually moving alloys around and also diffusing alloys. So micro-macro segregation. What it does is that it dynamically computes the solidification path during considering nucleation, segregation, and cooling conditions. So it's very comprehensive view of all the different processes that happen during the solidification. It also gives us information on microstructures, particular grain size and secondary dendritic arm spacing, and then it also gives us mechanical properties. So when we model parts like you see on the right, so the kind of outputs you'll get are secondary SDAS or porosity or yield strength and those sorts of things. How does it work? Well, in the user interface, you will select your base alloy and then quite simply enter your weight percentage of alloy elements, silicon, copper, magnesium. I see a spelling mistake, so we'll have to correct that before the release, and iron, zinc, etc. So that's actually how simple it is, and then you'll go to your models and choose the full chemistry-based solidification, which is what you'll be seeing when you open 5.1 in just a few weeks. So just to summarize here, what you'll get is element composition, phase formation, these are fairly advanced kind of outputs, cooling rate, solidification time, grain size, SDAS, dimensionless Naama criterion, and then mechanical properties, both as cast and after heat treatment. So that's really progress for us. That's very good. And so, but you know, ultimately, the benefit here is increased accuracy also for porosity regions and shin grips. So whole range of benefits in using this new model that we've developed. Okay, yeah, just examples there, like for instance, elongation. We'll be talking about this specific case in August in more detail. Okay, so stay tuned. Flow 3D cast v5.1 chemistry based solidification model theory validation and practical usage. Okay, so new features, new workspaces. So beyond the models, of course, we have numerics. That's important. You have to have a software that's completely parallelized, that can run on 100 cores, 200 cores, 1,000 cores. That's important in terms of running things fast. We have some advanced component-based conforming meshing. So that's also a way of accelerating your simulations. And then we have high-performance computing, means you can get on the cloud and run your models on 200 cores. Advanced post-processing, of course, is also very important. You have to be able to quickly find your hotspots, your porosity analysis, your air entrainment, et cetera, all those things. So that's really all important. But ultimately, what you really need in addition to all of that is an environment that caters to your specific application and an environment that serves as a roadmap to modeling success. And that's why we developed Flow 3D Cast Process Workspaces. So we'll talk about this for the remainder of this presentation. So what we're trying to do with the process workspace is streamline the workflow, select optimal model process parameters, and also guide you basically to the completion of a successful design. So in 5.0, we had HPDC, LPDC, LPSC, gravity die casting, sand casting, tilt pour, and loss foam. And now what we've added in, we've completed the picture. What we've added in 5.1 is centrifugal casting, investment casting, continuous casting, and sand core making. So let's talk about these 5.1. That's what this looks like graphically, but let's talk about what's in 5.1. So before we do that, what is a process workspace? So what we'll do is preload geometry types and databases that are appropriate for what you are doing. So cooling channels will be important for permanent molds type applications. You could build those in databases. It could be a shell type geometry. So we kind of pre-select what's needed for the specific process that you're working with. And we'll also preload the best defaults that are appropriate for the physical models and that are appropriate for the model settings, because something you're doing with loss foam may not be the optimal kind of settings for something when you're doing sandcasting, for instance. So we'll pre-select things for you. You can always change them, of course, but we've kind of done the work of saying, well, in this type of application, you're better off using these process defaults. And in this application, you're better off using these. So what we're trying to do here is to make the simulation setup intuitive, quick, and successful. That's what we are after. But you still preserve the ability to change whatever you want. We're not hiding anything from you. We're just pre-selecting. And then if, for whatever reason, you would like to change something, by all means, it's there for you to do. So generally, what we can talk about here is just follow the guide. So on the left here, we have a process toolbar. And what we're going to do is basically follow the guide, global, time, etc. I'll show you what this looks like. So for instance, we'll start here. We have a different icons, different widgets that open up. So let's say global. Well, what's that going to be? Well, today, let's say we're doing investment casting, and the sub-process type will be a solidification model. So sometimes you start with a solidification to design your feeders and risers and all that. Or you can start with a fill. That's fine too. There'll be some time controls. So you'll say when you want to start and finish, what models you want to activate. You'll go on to your geometry, so you'll create your shell molds based on your casting part, etc., and so on. So you basically just follow the steps there. Just to give you an example of a part here, which is step one, you would then, in the geometry widget, you would basically activate the shell creation and then move on to having your shell, and that's your source of metal there in this case, where we would pour the metal. So for investment casting, okay, so we choose, you know, these are your process workspaces that you can choose from. So we'll choose investment casting, choose, okay, let's say fill or certification in this case, and we are actually in this case creating from a previous fill. So things are connected, different stages are connected for you. And then in this case, we'll have full radiation model. Why? Because we're doing investment casting. So this is pre-selected for you. If you were doing sand casting, the radiation model would be turned off by default. If you're doing investments, well, by default, the full radiation model would be turned on. Your different outputs that you would like to have, if you're doing a solidification, clearly porosity, solid fraction, those sorts of things are going to be pre-selected for you by default. In your geometry types, what you'll see here, there's something called WYSIWYN. What you see is what you need, is we will make visible the shell mold for you. If you were doing investment casting, you would hide that away because you don't need to see it. I'm sorry, not investment. If you're doing sand casting, we would hide the shell mold because you just don't need, it doesn't need to be there cluttered in your workspace. So that's the idea there with process workspaces. Okay, as a summary here, 5.0 and 5.1, we really have now basically the whole thing for you. So choose your process, choose your analysis stage, process meaning centrifugal investment, etc. Your analysis stage might mean thermal dye cycling, it might mean fill, it might mean cooling, it might mean solidification, so on. And then follow the roadmap and then post-process results. That's the whole idea behind workspaces. So let's look at sand core making, which is interesting because sand core making is actually nothing to do with metal. It's sand. What we are trying to do is successfully create a sand core. And so what we're doing here is determining the core box performance for a given design. So we have three ways or three processes that are modeled: hot box, cold box, inorganic. Hot box is heat cured sand binder mixture. Cold box is amine gas curing, and then inorganic is we basically drying the sand with hot air. And there's two steps. One is to shoot or blow the sand mixture into the molds. And what you're looking here is for a full, a complete fill. And what you need to do is position and size different air vents. That's the kind of the name of the game. And what you're looking for is a full, but also a reasonable density everywhere. If things are low density, if the sand is kind of not very compact, that's also potentially a source of weakness later on. So what you're trying to do here is evaluate the sizing and positioning of air vents. And then step two is how is this sand actually drying or curing? So let's look at moisture content in general. So we have an example here, shooting a water jacket sand core. And what these things are here, these are air vents, different sizes. And so we get, and the sand is going to come from these locations here. We're going to push this through. I'm going to play this video. So this is not metal, just to be clear. This is sand. This is a sand mixture. Sand mixture actually is a granular flow. And so it's kind of looks like a fluid when it's being filled, but it's not. It's sand, okay? So we see this, and what we're looking at here is a density. So there's some regions with a pretty high density, and then some regions where it's, you know, literally half the density. So this means that the sand is much looser in these regions. In addition, I'll show you a different, same parts, but a different view of it. You may also not be filling the whole box. And what you can see here are some regions where in fact the sand isn't even filling the box. And that's a problem with venting and or with you know, delivery. So that's something that you can trace and analyze before going into production. So next step two is drying or curing the sand, and then that's also done by pushing gas in various places and letting the sand dry. So it's not automatic that everything is going to dry equally. And so that's the point of this stage of the analysis. And so you can see the moisture content kind of reducing. You need databases to do this. So we provide those. You need sand mixtures, you need gases. Everything behaves just a little bit differently. And then you need air vents. So we provide those databases for you as well. And I have an example here, which is quite interesting. It's a core drying simulation. That's the part, and we are going to let it dry in just a moment. That's what the part looks like. And then what you'll see there is we are pushing some air in different locations, and you're going to see how this starts to dry as the air makes its way. You see that through the parts. So this is moisture being removed. And what you'll see here is that the two regions which actually do not get properly dried. And that's because of the positioning of the vents. So what happens next? Well, you look at the actual parts. This is where the defect is on the top left, and this is also where the defect is, which is exactly where we see the defects in the simulation. Okay, so that's encouraging. Continuous casting. So that's also an interesting one. It's we've been able to do this for a long time actually, but setting it up is never been completely straightforward. So that's why we created a process workspace to help you with that. And so there's a couple of three types of continuous casting that we typically model with. So continuous slab casting, continuous sheet casting, and direct chill casting. And one of the challenges computationally is how do we move solidified metal? So you know, metal comes in molten and it solidifies, but in other processes the solidified metal doesn't move beyond the point once, you know, it's been solidified. In continuous casting, it continues to move. In fact, that's exactly what the process is all about, so moving solidified metal. So we have ways of doing this, and what we do with the process workspace is make it easy for you to set this up. Something that's quite difficult, complicated to set up, where we trace the steps for you so that you can model this. So a couple of examples there. I'll run this one. So what we are looking at is a direct chill. So we have a portion here of solid metal, which is then being drawn down, and this is liquid metal. And as this moves out, we are we have to make sure that we have some solid metal on the sides here, so that nothing leaks, obviously. But then we're interested in all sorts of things here, but mostly the evolution of temperature and solid content as you make work your way through. This is a similar problem, different slightly different settings. So that's how that works. Another example is a rotating drum, and what this drum is doing is basically dragging along metal which solidifies in the process, and as it solidifies, it's going to, well, eventually, solid fraction here, eventually it's going to make its way out in this process. So this is liquid metal down here, and this is solid metal leaving and being dragged along here basically by the rotating drum. So that's another process that we are able to model. And then there's another one here, continuous casting of a slab. And in this case, what these holes are actually cooling channels. And this is how we modulate the solidification of the slab, of the liquid metal, as it makes its way through these rollers here. All right, so those are just a few examples of how this works. So let's talk about investment casting a little bit. And the key features here are, number one, an advanced radiation model, which is very important for investment casting. It's the one process where you really need to have a proper radiation model in place in order to capture all the proper heat exchanges between different parts. And then you need a shell generation tool. So we've included that in the process workspace. And also you need a shell conforming meshing. That's for optimal numerical performance. So we've included that as well in the workspace. So you'll have your shell and your meshing instead of having a kind of, a cube around this or rectangle type of Cartesian mesh. What we have here is a mesh that basically hugs the shape of your shell, and then you can save an enormous amount of computational resources in this fashion. Okay, so how does it work? You'll start with your parts. You will open the create shell mold kind of dialogue here. It looks a bit complicated, but it's actually incredibly simple. You just go to fit mesh. You'll choose your mesh cell size for your shell generation, and then you will choose your shell thickness. So you just want your shell size to be a little bit, you know, smaller than your shell thickness. That's the only rule there. And that's it. Press preview shell, then okay, and you're done. This shell is 7.5 millimeters. It could be 12 millimeters. Could be 7.5 is quite thin, but you can decide that, and then you can also, of course, decide the material that you want, what kind of ceramic you want. So what does this look like? I have a few post-processing examples here, and look at the bubbles. It's just remarkable. So this is a first iteration of a design. You can see all these bubbles making their way out. There's a lack of venting here, which is why this is not filling up completely, and so on. So you can look at a very detailed view of the fill. You can look, this is a different setting. It's a slower flow rate, and they've added a bit of venting here between the parts to alleviate some of the problems, but we don't actually get rid of all of the problems. But if you're wondering what these, you can see these, they're kind of gas bubbles. They are gas bubbles. These gas bubbles making their way up, floating upwards, those are collapsed voids. So, you know, the process of, let's do this again, the process is, you know, very turbulent. There's a lot of air entrainment that happens at the beginning. You can see that. These particles, these little voids get trapped and then collapse, and then they become air bubbles. And we track those bubbles. You can see here, it's kind of interesting. You see the bubbles here, they're going to make their way up. You see that? And so on, make their way up here, through here. So you can see all that in great detail, how things are going to be able to escape or not escape. And if they don't escape, that's the whole problem. You end up having problems in your casting. And then, of course, you have to look at solidification. Liquid metal on the left, solidified metal on the right, so you can look at the last places that solidify. But this doesn't tell you all your problems, because you do have problems there. In the absence of venting, this is actually not filling completely. So you have some major defects with this part, which will have to be addressed one way or another. And then there's a porosity tool that also is quite useful in order to see where you have different regions of porosity. And you can, you know, there's micro porosity or macro porosity. So Brigman method for investment cooling, so this is related to directional solidification, especially for turbines. It's quite important that you have a cooling in a specific direction. And you do that by moving your mold through the furnace. There's a heat zone, and you're able to control the directionality of the cooling. So we have something for that. And you know, the net results, if you look at a turbine here, is you see this kind of directional cooling that happens exactly the way you want it to in a controlled process. So we can model that as well. This is for investment casting. And then we have the last one here, centrifugal casting. So let's take a look at that. So bunch of different things you can do, vertical, horizontal, and centrifuge, so non-axis symmetric. And there's different models you have available, non-inertial reference frame, axis symmetric, general moving object. kind of details, but they all serve different purposes. And you can do this in either cylindrical or Cartesian coordinates. So we did things in all Cartesian. Now we've added cylindrical coordinates, which is particularly useful for pipe casting, centrifugal pipe casting. So this is a nice improvement there. So we've set that up for you. And what this looks like is a, well, this is what it looks like. We have a kind of rotating drum, and we're pouring metal. And what we are looking for is the evolution of wall thickness over time. So you can get a lot of detail, incredible amount of detail, actually. You can look at, you see this, as the front kind of progresses over time towards the end of the pipe. So that's one example. We have one here that's, apologize, it's a bit low resolution. What's happening here is a centrifuge casting. So you're going to see the metal initially makes it difficult to see. I've got a better video in the next slide. Initially makes its way all the way to the outer extremities and then works its way back into the mold. That's how the progression of that fill sequence. So it's a bit difficult to see. So I'm going to show you something just a little bit different in just a second, but you can see, you know, this is a very typical shape for a high velocity centrifuge process. You know, there's kind of a bell shape or U shape as the flow is kind of forced outwards. Another way of looking at this, this is actually on the left a different speed, but now we are moving with much slower, but we are moving with the mold. And what you can see here is the same thing, where the mold is filling first and then how it back kind of back floods to complete the process. So you can look at these things great detail one way, either with a moving reference frame or with a moving part. Has another example of a flange. And so what this is going to do is basically fill up, and it's going to build metal over time, basically. It takes a while. I think I fast-forwarded it a little bit at some point. Maybe not, but this is going to connect here, and then over time you'll have constant thickness here. So another example of how this works, how this model can work for you. And then the last example I have with centrifugal casting, this is kind of what I was saying about the rotating frame. So this is, you're moving with the frame, so this is what you're seeing. If you were basically sitting on this ring here, or then this is seen from the outside. So you can see the fill sequence, the backflow, potentially air entrapments, bubble defects, all those things. Really, if you look at the detail, I mean, I'll just play this again here a little bit. The detail right here, just focus on this for a moment. See how the fluid is ejected to the outer bounds and then makes its way backwards here. See that? Then eventually fills the entire cavity. So that's it for this kind of preview of what's in 5.1. And then just a quick mention of Flow-3D Cloud in case you're not aware. The way this works is that you open Flow-3D Cast in your web browser and set up your model in your browser, and you can do the post-processing in your browser. What you've done basically is through your browser log into a remote virtual machine, and in turn that virtual machine, virtual desktop, is connected to thousands of CPU cores, thousands, and you can run your models here from the comfort of your browser. So you may have a 16 core machine under your workstation. It's not quite powerful enough for one massive simulation maybe that you have. Well, you can push that out to the cluster and run it there. So, well, what's nice about it? Well, sounds like a slogan, but it, it it really is what it is, unlimited power and total flexibility. Why? Because you can run on as many cores as you want, and you can also run as many simultaneous simulations as you want. You can run 50 simulations at once, each on, I don't know, 80 cores each, if you want. You have that power and you have the flexibility, which you don't have, obviously, on your local workstation. So this can be done on demand. So if you have a one-off large simulation, occasional large simulations, or occasionally you need to run, I don't know, 10 simulations all at once because you're in a rush, you can do that on demand. And you can basically open your browser and start using Flow-3D on the cloud. Or you can do a subscription, which is cheaper than on demand, but it also assumes that you have a kind of steady use of a need for modeling. And this same thing, you run your simulations from anywhere browser, but once you've got the subscription, you only pay for the hardware. And the hardware is just, you know, basically renting the cores as you use them. It's per hour, per minute even of usage, I think. Okay, so that's Flow-3D Cloud. And, you know, things do run faster. Something that might take 24 hours on a single node, you know, can be run in a third of the time using more cores in that fashion. So things do run faster. Take home message. I hope what I showed you is that 5.1 offers an incredibly versatile, accurate, and complete solution for the industry. That's the way I think of this. It's versatile, it's accurate, and it's complete. I can't really think of any casting simulation that I would not be able to do because of, you know, physical model limitations or anything like that with Flow-3D Cast. It's very, very complete, very versatile, very accurate. And the process workspace design philosophy that we've deployed in the last two releases really hopes to deliver a hassle-free user experience. The idea here is that we guide you through model setup all the way through to design success. So thank you for tuning in. Any questions? You know, just email us. It can be simpler, info@flow3d.com. And I'll leave it at that. And we'll see you in August, I hope, to talk about in much more depth about the new solidification model that's available in 5.1. Thank you, everyone. Until next time.